Hello. Welcome to World Class Sunday School. Thank you for tuning in to this Sunday's Sunday School lesson. I am Diann Morgan, your guest teacher. I would like to thank Brother Dorsey for allowing me to stand in for him today. We have a great Sunday School lesson. Our title of our lesson is Improbable Hope. Our scripture for our lesson is Genesis, the 21st chapter, the 8th through the 20th verse. Our key verse scripture is Genesis, the 21st chapter, the 17th through the 18th verse. Let's talk about the main characters for our lesson. The main characters are Abraham, his wife Sarah, Sarah's maid Hagar, Isaac, Abraham and Sarah's son, and Ishmael, Abraham and Hagar's son. That might sound a little strange to you that Abraham has two children in this same lesson, but as we begin to talk about it, I believe you'll understand it a little better. Let's do a little background before we get into today's lesson. The story in this part of Genesis is talking about Abraham. Abraham was a man that God showed great favor to because Abraham truly believed in the Lord. So God came to Abraham and told him that he wanted him to travel from his home of comfort, where he had great wealth because he had a beautiful wife, he had a lot of land, he had a lot of servants. The Lord came to him one day and told him to pack all these people up and all his stuff, all his belongings, and travel to a land that he would show him. And because Abraham loved the Lord and he believed the Lord, he didn't question it. He packed up and he went to the land that God told him to go to. Now, just think about that. How many of you are willing to do that? That God tells you to pack up your family, leave your comfort, leave all your relatives, and go to another place that you will be shown. But Abraham did just that because he trusted God. And we're going to find out that God truly blessed Abraham because he was so obedient. As Abraham left his home, he had to travel across a lot of different land, a lot of different kingdoms. He did come across a kingdom called Gerar, which was under the rule of King Abimelech. And he ran into a bit of trouble when he got to Gerar, because you see, Abraham was married to a very beautiful woman named Sarah. Even though Sarah was advanced in her age by our numbers of today, she was maybe 65, maybe even 70 years old at the time, which in today's age is considered to be elderly. May not be quite so old in that time because people were living to be several hundreds of years of age. But because of Sarah's beauty, Abraham felt a little fear traveling in King Abimelech's land because he felt like they would be captured, and if they knew that Sarah was his wife, that they would take Sarah from him and they would kill him, but they would the king would marry and possibly even abuse Sarah. So he and Sarah concocted this story that she was his sister and Sarah was taken away from him, but that was not God's plan. So what did God do? He came to King Abimelech in a dream and told him, let that woman go. She's married. She's not yours to have. And if you do not let her go, a certain punishment will be placed on you by me. And that frightened Abimelech. So we know that Abimelech had heard of God and had great respect for God because he did let Sarah go. And Sarah and Abraham were able to travel on their way. Now, Sarah at this time was barren. She had been married to Abraham for quite some time. I don't know exactly how many years, but she had been married to him past the time that she should have had a child or some children. And as you know, especially those who study the Bible, you know that having the ability to give your husband a child is one of the greatest gifts that any woman could present to their husband. And Sarah had not been able to do that. Try as she might, she'd not been able to accomplish that. And God had told him, I'm going to bless you with a son. And what did Sarah do? Sarah laughed. I might have done that too if I was her age. Like, really, God? I'm 70, 80 years old, and I'm going to be able to bear a child. But we know that God is not a man that he should lie, that we can trust God, that when he tells us something, it will most definitely come true. But Sarah, like a lot of us, didn't believe it, and she came up with a plan to help God out. How many of you know that God does not need our help? That God is able to do anything that he pleases without us helping him out? So that's where we're coming to in today's story. So I want to read you the key verse first, which is Genesis, the 21st chapter, the 17th through the 18th verse. And God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, What aileth thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad and hold him in thine hand, for I will make him a great nation. Amen. We're going to come back to that because that's going to be important. I want to read to you some pre-scriptures. Let's start at Genesis, the 21st chapter and the first verse, and read to verse 7, just to give you a little background of where our lesson is taking us to today. Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the very time that God had promised him. Abraham gave the son the name Isaac that Sarah bore him. When his son Isaac was 8 days old, Abraham circumcised him, and as God had commanded him to do. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born. Sarah said, God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me. And she added, Who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. Now think about that. So let's go back just a little bit. If you remember, I told you that Sarah came up with a scheme to help God out, because God had promised Abraham and had told Sarah, I am going to bless you with a son. And as I just read, Sarah said that that would be laughter, and we'll find out that that's what the name Isaac means. But here's what Sarah did. Sarah wanted to please her husband so much that she came up with the idea that her slave, her handmaiden, her personal servant, Hagar, an Egyptian woman, would lie with her husband, Abraham. And Sarah told her to do it, so Hagar really had no choice. And basically in that time and age, even a bondswoman or a slave or a personal maiden to a woman of the house was also basically married or could be someone that the man of the house would lie with or would know or would have sexual relationship with. In that day and age, that was not uncommon. So Sarah decided, I'm going to help God out. So Hagar, I want you to lay with my husband and give him a child. So Hagar did that. She laid with Abraham and she had a son. And that's the goal of every woman, even in today's time, but especially then, that if you got pregnant, that you had a son, especially that first child. So Hagar had a son and named him Ishmael. And as we will learn, Ishmael means God will hear. Ishmael will need God to hear as the lesson goes on. But when Hagar got pregnant, she knew this was a wonderful thing. But she did something that was unthinkable. She began to flaunt her pregnancy in front of Sarah and really angered Sarah and made Sarah very upset and made Sarah jealous. So let me ask you this question. Suppose you were working a job and your boss gives you a certain task to do, and you do that job to the very best of your ability. In fact, you excel. You go above what was required of you. And then when you get it done and you present it to the boss at first seemed pleased, and then something strange happened. The boss became angry, and the boss even fired you for doing the very thing he asked you to do or she asked you to do, and you did it with perfection. Well, that's basically what Sarah did. She gave Hagar a command to sleep with her husband, have sex with him, and to bear him a child, and that's what she did. Not only did she bear him a child, she bore him a male child. But Hagar did something that should not have taken place, is she mocked her mistress. So here comes today's lesson. So as time went by and Ishmael grew older and stronger, approximately about maybe 14 years had passed and Sarah did get pregnant. Not only did Sarah get pregnant, but she had the child that the Lord had promised her and her husband. She had a male child and she named him Isaac. And Isaac began to grow. Isaac was very healthy. Sarah was able to breastfeed him and keep him healthy and keep him strong. So enters today's lesson. Our first outline is entitled, A Familiar and Strange Source of Injustice. Think about that, a familiar and strange source of injustice, because we're talking about a just God. So our lesson says, the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. Now, we didn't hear anything about Abraham making a great feast when Ishmael was born, or any hoopla or any fanfare, but this is the promised child, the child that God promised him and his wife Sarah. So he was very grateful for this. So he was showing God and showing Sarah how much he appreciated the fact that he was able to conceive a son by the woman that he loved so much. And in verse 9, but Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had born to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So Sarah sees Ishmael playing with her son Isaac, and Sarah didn't like that. So she said to Abraham, cast out this slave woman and her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac. So here Sarah is already thinking, because Isaac is about 3 or 4 years old at this time. He's just a small kid at this time. And Ishmael is a teenager. So Sarah's thought is that Ishmael is mocking him, that he's making fun of him. And she doesn't like that. It's how dare you make fun of my son, and you're the son of a slave woman, my bondswoman. And that's how we sometimes think of other people, that we're on a different level than them, that we're on a pedestal, that we're seen as supreme. So we have to be very careful that we don't think too highly of ourselves, because God sees us all as the same. So it's important that we see ourselves and we see others as God sees us. But right now, Sarah is not feeling like that. But sometimes as a mother, we do feel that type of bond with our children, that we don't want anybody else to make fun of them or feel entitled to anything that they should inherit. So Sarah wants to make sure that Ishmael doesn't inherit anything that Abraham has. So she told Abraham to put them out. Put them out. Not only is she going to tell him to put them out, she wants him to send them away with nothing. No inheritance, nothing but the very clothes on their back. And poor Abraham, as we go along a lesson, we'll find out that he basically was stuck with doing just that. So we need to be very careful how we treat people. It's very important, because it can come back to haunt us, or it can backfire on us. So it's important that we remember to treat everybody with dignity and respect, and to treat people right, and to treat people fairly, because that's how we want God to treat us. So let's travel a little further in our lesson. Verse 11. The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. Abraham had not forgotten that Ishmael was his son. This was his very blood. And notice the term distressing. Abraham was distressed because he knew that this was his son. Imagine that you're a man out there and you have a child by another woman, and your wife has told you, don't feed that child, don't pay any child support, don't visit that child, you would be very stressed because that child is your very blood. So somehow you have to find a way to calm the situation down, because Abraham is still in the household with his wife, which is Sarah, whom he loves very much. But not only that, he's in the household with his son that God promised him. Verse 12 says, but God said to Abraham, so now we see God intervening. But God said to Abraham, do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. You notice it's the boy, not Ishmael, and your slave woman, not Hagar. So it does show you what their level is in the house, that they are servants in the house because they weren't given a name. So verse 12 says, but God said to Abraham, do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you to do, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. So God has told Abraham not to be distressed. Isn't it odd or peculiar that God told Abraham to do what Sarah told him? Now, you know why? Because God had already promised Sarah and Abraham a son of their own. There was no plan for Ishmael or Hagar to be a part of this plan that God had given them. It was because Sarah and Abraham decided to do their own thing apart from what God had instructed them to do. How many of you know when we fall out of line with God's plans that things can go awry, things can go astray, there can be a mishap? It's very important that we do what God tells us to do, but imagine poor Abraham. He's got two women in the house. He's got two sons in the house. He's torn between what to do. I'm sure Abraham was a man of compassion, a man of feeling that this is a servant woman of mine. I'm charged with taking care of my servant, but not only that, she bore me a son. How can I just turn them out? But God has told me what to do, and I need to do it. But I do want to point out to you that Proverbs, the 21st chapter, the 9th verse says, it's better to live on a corner of a rooftop than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. So right now, Abraham has a quarrelsome wife that he has to deal with. He has to figure out how to make Sarah happy and how to restore order to his household. But God has given him the answer. Verse 13 reads, as for the son of the slave woman, yet again, no mention of Ishmael's name or Hagar's name. So they don't have the status that the Abraham and the Sarah of the day had. They are but servants or slaves. As for the son of the slave woman, notice it didn't say your son, the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring. So God recognizes that it was through no fault of Ishmael that he came into this world. It was the fault of his master and mistress, Abraham and Sarah, coming up with this scheme to help God out. It wasn't even the fault of Hagar. She was given the instructions to lay with Abraham. And she had to do that because he was her master. It says, while Abraham is in flux, God intervenes. Because Abraham doesn't know what to do. He's got Hagar here. I'm sure Hagar was looking very pitiful because Hagar probably has lived in their house for a long time. And while she was a slave woman, she was still probably accustomed to some luxuries that people who were maybe homeless or people who lived on the outside were not accustomed to. People who maybe had to work in the fields or tend to the animals or tend to the gardens. She was the personal servant to Sarah. So she probably enjoyed some luxuries that some other workers didn't. So I'm sure she's great distress. She probably wasn't accustomed to being hungry or being thirsty, but we're about to find out that she's going to be both. But just think about what God has promised is going to happen, that he is going to take care of Ishmael. God will make a nation for Ishmael, that he won't be left just wondering about, that he will be taken care of and he won't be forgotten, and that he too will have offsprings. Our third outline, despair and dire straits. This is what was left to happen to Ishmael and his mother Hagar. So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child. So they mentioned Hagar's name the first time in this part of the lesson, but still no mention of the child's name. So Abraham is still not completely living up to his responsibilities by calling the child by his name, Ishmael. So since I'm reading this again, so Abraham rose early in the morning. So when people rise early in the morning, it means that they have great respect what God has told them to do, that they don't, you know, squander the day, that they don't just do it when they get ready, that they do it in a timely fashion. It's kind of like when you're going to your job, you should go there on time. Or when you're doing something for God, you should do it in a timely fashion. So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. So it's as if she doesn't really know where she's going. And remember, she's been living with Sarah as a personal servant for quite some time, maybe even as a young girl. But now she's sent to wander and to fend for herself. Verse 15, when the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. She can't stand to see her child suffer. The water's gone. The bread likely is gone. She's got a teenage child that she cannot take care of, and his father has turned them out and has abandoned them. Verse 16, then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off. She didn't sit down under the very bush with him, but she sat down so he could be within a distance that she could see him. But her heart was broken. She didn't know how to take care of her child. She could not provide for him. And they were put out to wander in a land they were not necessarily familiar with very little provision, some bread and some water. How would you like for that to happen to you? You've lived in this household. You've probably been a very good servant, and they just cast you out. Well, we don't want God to do that to us. And if we don't want God to do that to us, we need to be obedient and follow what God has for us. Follow God's plan, not our way. We need to take heed to that. And right now, Abraham is doing as God told him to do. But God has already told Abraham, I will take care of your son. Be not distressed. Because I'm sure Abraham really was distressed, because it's his son. It's his oldest son. And during that time, the oldest son carried a lot of weight. That was the person that was entitled to all the inheritance. But we know that couldn't happen in this case because it was not ordained by God. Because God had told Sarah and Abraham, I'm going to give you a child. You just need to be patient. You just need to wait. Well, Sarah's 90, Abraham's 100. But guess what? God did just what he told them he was going to do. Give them a child. Verse 15, when the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Verse 16, then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, do not let me look on the death of my child. And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. Can you hear her weeping? Can you feel the sorrow in her heart, thinking, I did just what Sarah asked me to do. This is what she told me to do, and I did it. And look at how I am being repaid. But those of us who know the rest of the story know that God has a ram in the bush. Because we know that later on, God is going to provide a lamb in the bush for Abraham. Because he's going to give him some instructions for what he must do with Isaac. But that's a little later on coming. So in verse 17, The fourth outline, God intervenes again. God intervened, had already intervened because he had given them that promised man child. Now, here comes God again intervening. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is." So it's likely that Ishmael knew about God. He was raised in the house of his father who feared God. It is likely that Hagar knew about God because God sent an angel to speak to Hagar because they had lived in the household of Abraham, a person that God truly loved. So we know that God is going to take care of Ishmael because he's already told Abraham that he plans to. And now he's telling Hagar. Verse 18, "Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Remember, Ishmael at this time is about 17 years old, so he's not a little boy, but he's Hagar's son. And mothers, you know that our children don't ever become too big for us, that whatever distress they're in, we are in too. Verse 19, "Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink." You see how God provides for her, us? He provided for them. They're in the middle of nowhere, don't know where they are. But God said, "I am going to take care of you. Do not be distressed." Verse 20, "God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow." So as you can see, God provided for Hagar, and then he provided for Ishmael. We know this is so because he had already told his father, "Do not stress. Don't be in flux. I am going to take care of Ishmael. He is going to be a great huntsman. He is going to be the father of a great nation. He is going to bear offspring." So that means that Abraham is going to be a grandfather, great-grandfather to infinity. So justice is manifested through God. We are powerless when it comes to not doing what God says. So thank you so much for listening today. I truly hope that you learned a lot from today's lesson. And we'll see you next time in World Class Sunday School.